Subcommittee will come to order. This morning we'll be focusing on the southwest border and the challenges that the Department of Homeland Security continues to face in that part of our country. Our southwestern border region possesses a rich history, a shared culture interwoven over the centuries, and lands of unsurpassed natural beauty. It's not a faraway alien place, but an inextricable part of our homeland, with millions of hardworking families and a vital and diverse economy. Cross-border trade is an important part of the picture. 80% of Mexico's exports and half of its imports are with the United States, and 10% of our country's overall trade is with Mexico. However, these trade statistics exclude illicit drugs. Over 90% of the cocaine entering our country is estimated to pass through Mexico, which is also our country's largest supplier of marijuana and methamphetamines. The U.S. appetite for drugs has nurtured powerful and corrupting cartels with tens of billions of dollars in criminal proceeds. These international criminal organizations routinely violate our borders to traffic drugs and weapons and money and to smuggle undocumented aliens. But it's the violence of these cartels and the fear and disruption they sow that now dominate the news. Over 18,000 people, including 79 Americans, have died in Mexico since President Calderon confronted the cartels. The brutality, the wanton disregard for bystanders, including women and children, and the apparent impunity with which the cartels have operated is appalling. The question we raised in prior hearings and will explore today is whether and to what degree are we making progress against the cartels, making our borders harder to exploit, and reducing the risk that violence will spread. I believe there's not much point in debating to what extent cartel violence has spilled over into the United States. Our close relationship with Mexico means we cannot ignore the violence there, regardless of when and whether it crosses the line physically. The deaths in March of three persons in Ciudad Juarez, associated with the U.S. consulate, intensified assaults against Border Patrol agents, including the murder of two, the kidnapping and murders of U.S. residents in Texas, and the recent homicide of an Arizona rancher, all remind us of the threats of narco-violence. The truth is, the cartels are engaged in criminal activity every day in cities and communities on both sides of the border, and not just along the border. We need to focus on meaningful ways to deal with cartels and their violence on the border and beyond. This hearing falls on the first anniversary of the administration's announcements of its Southwest Border Initiative. Secretary Napolitano noted during her recent visit to Mexico that CBP and ICE's enhanced efforts have resulted in record seizures of drugs, firearms, and smuggled illicit cash. She also cited unprecedented cooperation with Mexico on information sharing, joint training, cross-border communications, and trade. Today, from our witnesses, we'll want an assessment of how successful DHS efforts are or can become. And we'll pose such questions as, how would you grade efforts to prosecute drug and trafficking cases in Mexico, given that Mexico has its own immigration issues? Will our cooperation help improve U.S. security against attempts by non-Mexicans to enter the U.S. through Mexico? Does the fiscal year 2011 budget enable CBP and ICE to sustain a long-term effort to counter the cartels? How effective are joint efforts with federal, state, and local agencies, including backing them up when they're seriously outmanned or outgunned? We also want to understand how investments that we've made to date are complicating life for the cartels. These include the Secure Border Initiative, the Border Enforcement Security Task Forces, the deployment of air and marine assets, tunnel detection, and the establishment of forward operating locations or checkpoints. Our subcommittee is pleased to welcome this morning Commissioner Alan Bersin of U.S. Customs and Border Protection and Assistant Secretary John Morton, the Director of U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, to bring us up to date on the status of this initiative in light of expanded staffing, equipment, and other resources that Congress has provided to enable your agencies to work with federal, state, and local partners, as well as with the government of Mexico to overcome the cartels. Assistant Secretary Morton appeared here last November on this topic, but this is Commissioner Bersin's first time before the subcommittee. Commissioner, we welcome you. We expect that your initial year at the DHS, along with your unique law enforcement and personal experience, has given you a realistic perspective on what can be accomplished on the border. We look forward to hearing from you, from both of you today. We'll insert your complete statements in the hearing record, so we'll ask you to summarize your presentation in a five-minute oral presentation. We'll begin with Commissioner Bersin, followed by Assistant Secretary Morton, but we first want to turn to our distinguished ranking member, Mr. Rogers, for his comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for this hearing, because there is no more important topic for American security than the Southwest border. Commissioner Bersin, as the chairman says, this marks your first appearance before the subcommittee. Given your extensive experience working in Southern California and your service as this administration's border czar over the past year, I look forward to finally hearing your views on border security. And a welcome back to Assistant Secretary Morton. We meet again. I appreciate you being here and look forward to hearing your strong views on border enforcement as well. As the chairman noted, it's been just over a year since this administration launched its Southwest Border Security Initiative, an effort that has surged resources to further enhance our border security and support the courageous actions of the Mexican government against the cartels. While this initiative has resulted in some noteworthy seizures of drugs and bulk cash and modest interdiction of weapons, the murder rate continues to soar. The purity of marijuana and methamphetamine remains stubbornly high, and Mexico appears years away from sufficiently reforming its customs and immigration services as well as sustaining resilient local law enforcement. In fact, the cartels appear emboldened as ever, demonstrated by the continued escalation of violence and the recent assertion of a well-known Mexican drug lord to the media that, quote, Mexico's war on the drug trade is futile, even if cartel bosses are caught or killed, end of quote. Sobering. According to several published reports, mounting drug violence in Mexico has killed more than 19,500 people since President Calderon launched his effort against the cartels in 2006. Furthermore, the pace of homicides continues to escalate, most notably in Juarez, as the chairman said, where the average number of murders per month approaches 200, more than six murders a day on average in one city on the border in Mexico. But just as this drug war seems to be reaching a tipping point, I fear as though our political resolve to adequately sustain this fight is on the verge of slipping. The president's fiscal 11 budget not only curbs CBP's operational resources and reduces funding for border security technology and infrastructure, it also severely cuts the Coast Guard and its drug interdiction capabilities to the point where the amount of cocaine seized will decline by an estimated 11.3%. Explain that. Such reductions to operations will undoubtedly empower the cartels and put more pressure upon the border. In the midst of this drug war, with our border under siege, how can we possibly support a budget that is knowingly letting our guard down and allowing more drugs, more illegals, and contraband to flow across that border into this country. How can we justify this? And apart from DHS's flawed fiscal 11 budget request, there are other pressing questions. How can we accept the administration's recent pronouncements on the troubled SBI Net program when we've yet to receive the legislatively required expenditure plan for that program for the next fiscal year, for fiscal 10, current fiscal year? And why does the administration repeatedly assert that, quote, violence is not spilling over, quote, when, one, our own Justice Department admits the cartel's networks reach all across this country, into every city, and now almost every village, direct cartel organizations all across this land, not just on the border. Two, assaults against the Border Patrol continue to increase, and an agent was murdered in cold blood last year. Another with his face caved in a few days ago. A well-known Arizona rancher murdered last month on his own property. U.S. consulate personnel murdered. Another consulate bombed just this past weekend. And as the Washington Post reported on April 4, the cartel's contract killers are operating with near impunity on both sides of the border, but including the U.S. Contract killers hired by a foreign cartel murdering Americans. What are you going to do about that? And beyond the surge efforts of the past year and escalating violence, what are the next steps that need to be taken against this threat? If there's one thing I'm certain of from my experience as a state prosecutor in Kentucky for 11 years, a DA, and my years here in this body, it's that drugs pose a grave and unrelenting threat to the health and safety and security of the United States. Therefore, we must do all we can to secure that border, thwart these cartels, and put a stop to their savage criminality and their murderous ways. So the challenge being presented to DHS by this drug war is clear. My question, which is the same one I posed during our hearing on border violence last November, is whether or not we are up to the challenge. And when I pose this question, I am not wondering whether we have the proper resources in place to simply disrupt this organized cross-border crime. I'm wondering, just as I did last November, whether we have the will to actually break its back. Now, I realize that's a mighty tough chore. I'm quite certain it is a worthy fight, and surely this country has the capability to protect our border from organized criminal ventures spreading its tentacles across every inch of America. This is a serious, serious problem. Securing our border is not a mere luxury. Securing our border is a worthy fight that we must win. So today, Mr. Chairman, I'm not only interested in assessing our progress in this fight with the cartels, I'm interested in learning what more we can do to combat this clear and present threat to the United States and its citizens. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we will now begin with the Commissioner, Commissioner Bersin.
Good morning, Chairman Price, Ranking Member Rogers, members of the subcommittee and staff. I appreciate this opportunity to provide an update on our efforts to combat the threat of violence along the southwest border and to discuss my vision for the southern border as Customs and Border Protection's new commissioner. The committee has been extremely supportive of CBP over the years in meeting our difficult mission, and we are grateful for your support and your continued guidance. The significant investments that you have made in CBP helps protect our country from a variety of evolving threats, including those generated by organized criminal organizations operating transnationally in Mexico. Before serving as CBP commissioner, I worked for many years as a prosecutor on the border and in other positions with DHS and the Department of Justice. During this time, I have worked closely with both U.S. law enforcement colleagues at all levels, state, local, county, federal, and tribal, as well as with our counterparts in Mexico. The level of cooperation that we see today between the United States and Mexico under President Felipe Calderon is unprecedented and provides us with a historic opportunity. President Calderon's willingness to address the growing problems of drug cartels is nothing short of heroic. It presents a unique opportunity to expand and deepen coordinated law enforcement operations between our countries. We recognize that this is a journey that will not be accomplished overnight, but the important point is that it is a journey in which the first steps have been taken. Having worked and lived most of my life in border communities, I recognize the concerns of our citizens regarding drug-related violence that has taken place on both sides of the border. It has been and continues as a deeply serious threat. Most recently, the tragic murder of Robert Krentz, an Arizona rancher and a leader in his community, is an outrage and a tragedy. It points to the continuing problem. Secretary Napolitano has committed significant resources to bring this killer or killers to justice. Immediately after the shooting, CBP provided air and marine assets and trackers to find signs of the suspects. Furthermore, CBP dispatched additional mobile surveillance systems, supplemented regular aerial surveillance, and transferred and deployed 64 additional Border Patrol agents into the area. While individual incidents of violence are not a new phenomenon along the border, we are determined to prevent the kind of widespread violence that continues to take place every day in northern Mexico from crossing the border over into the United States in the form in which it appears in Mexico. In March 2009, Secretary Napolitano announced the Comprehensive Southwest Border Strategy aimed at preventing spillover violence and to helping the government of Mexico crack down on drug cartels in that country. Over the past year, CBP has supported that initiative by adopting the doctrine of co-responsibility, acknowledging that drugs coming north is part and parcel of a cycle of violence that involves bulk cash and weapons going south. To deal with these issues, national security issues for both countries, CBP has increased our cooperation with Mexico to coordinate border inspections and law enforcement operations. We've enhanced our information sharing and continue to build on intelligence cooperation. We have developed joint strategic approaches to our common problems, and we've continued to increase our capacity building at ports of entry. Just last month, CBP opened the Operations and Intelligence Coordination Center in Tucson, Arizona. This new facility serves as a centralized location for gathering and disseminating real-time data, actionable information to help increase security along the southwest border and to put information into the hands of our agents on the ground. Since last November, when Acting Commissioner Jason Ahern testified before this subcommittee, CBP has continued its enhanced efforts on outbound operations to prevent weapons and currency that, in fact, fuel drug-related violence that continues in Mexico. As part of this strategy, we've expanded our license plate reader program, the LPR program. We've invested in non-intrusive technology, and we've deployed additional Border Patrol agents on the scene. We've also deployed mobile response teams, canine teams, and other resources to increase pulse and surge operations, looking at what is leaving our country as we concentrate on what is coming into our country. These outbound efforts have been successful. They are an important step in the right direction. Since the Southwest Border Initiative was launched last year, CBP has seized more than $30 million in illicit southbound cash along the Southwest border. Together with our cooperative efforts with ICE, the numbers are greater and growing. Let me take a concluding moment to address our future strategy. In addition to keeping America's border safe and secure, CBP recognizes that we must promote economic competitiveness throughout North America. Security and trade and commerce go hand in hand. Security comes first, but we can be economically competitive as we enhance our security. We will adopt strategies that simultaneously improve security and expedite legitimate trade and travel. Smarter targeting and risk segmentation allow law enforcement authorities like CBP to focus their energy on the relatively small amount of illegitimate cargo and crossings that pose a threat to our public safety, as well as to our economic prosperity. We can have enhanced security while reducing the cost and inconvenience to legitimate goods and lawful travelers. CBP has made tremendous strides in this area by implementing trusted traveler programs, such as the FAST program, the Free and Secure Trade Program, and the Secure Electronic Network for Travelers, the Sentry program, on the southern border. These programs complement the Global Entry program at our airports and the Nexus program on our northern border. They expedite entry for low-risk travelers and cargo while allowing our officers to focus on more high-risk individuals and shipments. Working with our public, private, and international partners, we believe that we can continue to have greater security and greater prosperity. Finally, let me thank you again for this opportunity to appear here, my first testimony as CBP's new commissioner. I'm honored to be able to share with you the good work the men and women of CBP do each day to safeguard our nation's security. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Mr. Morton.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Rogers, members of the committee, thanks once again for inviting me to appear before you to testify on this subject. Let me also take a moment to welcome my new colleague, Commissioner Bersin, to his post. Alan has great insight and experience when it comes to the border and to Mexico, and I look forward to working with him as we train ICE and CBP on making the border a much more secure and safe place. Since I last testified before you on this same subject, we have, as both the chairman and Mr. Rogers noted, witnessed several acts of violence against U.S. citizens, and in particular, we've seen the outrageous killing of three individuals associated with the U.S. consulate in Ciudad Juarez, and the cowardly murder of Mr. Krentz, the Arizona rancher in Cochise County near the Mexican border. First, let me just say on behalf of ICE, I extend our heartfelt sympathies to the families of Leslie Enriquez, her husband, Arthur Redelfs, as well as Jorge Alberto Sacelido Ceniceros, and to the family of Mr. Krentz. While I can't get into the specifics of the open and ongoing investigations into these cases, I can assure you of one thing. Both ICE and CBP acted very swiftly and aggressively in response to both sets of killings. We are working with our partners in Mexico and the United States as we speak to try to solve these murders and to bring the killers to justice. In the Krentz case, for example, ICE is the lead federal agency assisting the Cochise County Sheriff's Office with the investigation. We've assigned special agents full-time to the case. We have devoted the full resources of our office in Mexico to it, and we have offered a reward to bring the killers to justice. My message today to you is simple. ICE shares the concern that many have over the presence of organized crime in Mexico and along our border. We're committed to vigilance and to a sustained attack on the criminal networks that seek to smuggle drugs, guns, money, and people to and from Mexico. This commitment is more than rhetorical. Thanks to the increased appropriations we have received from this subcommittee over the past 2 years, there has never been in the history of our agency more ICE agents and deportation officers devoted to the southwest border. And the results are promising. Let me start with our staffing. Approximately a quarter of our special agents are devoted to our five SAC offices in the four border states. The same is true of our detention and removal officers, a quarter of our entire staffing. We have now 10 of our 17 border enforcement security task forces are on the southwest border, two in New Mexico, three in Arizona, and three in Texas. We have the 11th being formed in Mexico City itself. By the end of the year, we'll have 40 ICE agents in Mexico, both in Mexico City and in border cities along the border. Again, the largest presence we've ever had in any country in our history. We have six Special Assistant United States Attorneys devoted to prosecuting border cases in border U.S. Attorney's offices, and I am personally committed to significantly increasing that number, and we're in the process of working with the Deputy Attorney General to do just that. To give you some flavor of the results, over the past year, we have seen in our Houston office a 64% increase in drug seizures, in San Diego, 23% increase in drug seizures, a 40% increase in currency seizures, in Phoenix, a 15% increase in criminal convictions, and overall an 11% increase in administrative arrests of criminal offenders along the southwest border. As welcome as these successes are, we intend to do more. The drug trafficking cartels remain a very serious threat to both Mexico and the United States, fueling unacceptably high levels of violence in Juarez and elsewhere in Mexico. This is a fight. It's a very real, a very nasty fight. And it's one that will take deep resolve and deep commitment to win, but we have to win it. There is no rational alternative. ICE is aggressively going after the cartels and other organized criminals in Mexico in many ways. First, we are pursuing initiatives along the southwest border to stop bulk cash smuggling, drug trafficking, firearms trafficking. We're also attacking the alien smuggling industry and transnational gangs that operate on both sides of the border. And in this respect, we are increasingly doing it hand in hand with our other federal law enforcement partners, namely DEA, ATF, and FBI. Second, we're going to continue to match our powers of investigation, seizure, and deportation with CBP's impressive powers of inspection and interdiction. Between the two of us, working closely, we can make the border and the transit zones, both on the Mexican side and the U.S. Side, hostile places for criminal networks. Third, we're going to increase our joint efforts with Mexican law enforcement to investigate cases, share intelligence, and improve professionalism through training. And I really want to focus on the concrete here, real cases, real criminals, real jail time. Fourth, we need to develop much better intelligence sharing among all of the federal and local law enforcement agencies involved. And finally, I want to harness the full power of our local law enforcement partners, our intelligence offices, and our 10 Southwest Border BESs. All of these are described in more detail in my submitted written remarks, but they just reflect the absolute commitment we have to trying to get this right. Since my last testimony here, we've also stepped up our specific efforts in and around Juarez and in El Paso. This has involved taking such extraordinary steps as stopping all removals of criminals and non-criminals through Juarez. We are expanding the illegal drug program in which we prosecute with the Mexicans individuals in Mexico for offenses that occurred in the United States, and we're working with the Mexican equivalent of the best called the UNITO. Let me close by just saying that we've begun to see real results from our efforts. I can assure everyone here we are mindful of the seriousness of this problem. We spend an enormous amount of time trying to think about getting it right, doing things differently, being more innovative. It is a very, very serious challenge to us. Alan and I have talked about it a lot. We're both sort of sober individuals. We are not pretending in any way that this isn't a challenge that confronts our nation. We have a long, long history in federal law enforcement, and ultimately I think that it's going to be an important combination of the power of the federal government, cooperation with state and local law enforcement, and a much better and improved relationship with Mexico that will lead to success at the end. Thank you.
Thank you, and thanks to both of you for your testimony. I want to focus in initial questions on something you both referenced extensively, namely the cooperative efforts underway with the Mexican government. To get you to elaborate a bit on the results that's produced, what you expect from it, what you hope we can accomplish in that regard, because we all know that that cooperation is absolutely essential. The Secretary, Secretary Napolitano, along with her counterparts at State and Defense, met with their Mexican counterparts in February and March. They signed new agreements on intelligence sharing, border and air security cooperation. We'd be interested in your take on the significance of those agreements and what difference they will make in your work and what kind of results you would anticipate. But let me be a little more specific. I would like first Commissioner Bersin to ask you about the efforts on the Mexican side to greatly beef up military and law enforcement presence in the northern part of the country. When the president President Calderon took over in 2006, he put the Mexican military in charge of security and policing for Juarez and other northern Mexican areas, and it was reported at the time the local police were demoralized, there were corruption problems, they were overwhelmed by the cartels. Now there's been a replacement of those military forces, or at least a number of them, with federal police who have now arrived in Juarez as of April 8th. What can you tell us about that? What do we conclude from that? Is that good news in the sense of signaling an enhanced capacity from the police? I mean, what kind of mix of forces are we looking at here, and what would be your assessment of the way on the Mexican side these forces have been deployed?
Mr. Chairman, of all the remarkable changes that have taken place in Mexico and in the bilateral relationship with regard to confronting organized crime, one of the most extraordinary was the recognition and the public acceptance by President Calderon that much of Mexico's law enforcement machinery and much of its judiciary, if not all of it, were subject to corruption, and that corruption and the tentacles and the influence of organized crime had tainted law enforcement and the judiciary at all levels of Mexican society. Since that time, since 2006, they have begun, under President Calderon's leadership, the transformation of law enforcement into a reliable instrument of public policy, focusing for the most part on the federal police and the federal enforcement authorities. SSP, the Secretary of Public Safety, or Seguridad Pública, Ingeniero Engineer García Luna, Genaro García Luna, I think is a very positive step, and one that will, over time, begin to produce dividends. Secretary Napolitano, as well as Secretary Morton and myself, have been to the headquarters in Mexico City, which, just in an equipment and a technological sense, is impressive and indicates the commitment that's been made fiscally to build up a federal law enforcement presence. The plan is to move toward 20,000 federal police. And what we have seen recently in Juarez was the decision that recognized that while the military, because of the lack of local law enforcement, will continue to have a role to play in dealing with organized crime, that in fact the long-term solution was to substitute a military presence with a law enforcement presence. And that's beginning to happen in Juarez, in which the primary enforcement duties are being transitioned to Secretary Garcia Luna, with the military remaining, but in a protective stance. And I believe that is the way ahead, one that will show significant improvement in the near term as well as over the longer term.
So your assessment is that that is, number one, a mark of increased capacity, greatly improved capacity on the part of the police, and secondly, that that is the optimal long-term pattern, that that the military would remain in that supportive role, perhaps, but would not be the primary force.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I believe that is the strategy and that it's a sound one.
Let me turn to the Controlled Substance Pilot Project. That's an agreement between the Mexican Attorney General, ICE, and CBP that enables them, the Mexicans, to prosecute drug smuggling cases when, for whatever reasons, those cases are declined by the U.S. Attorney's Office. There's a similar program for alien smuggler prosecutions known as OASISS, the OASIS program. So, Assistant Secretary Morton, could you, your testimony refers to the first two convictions from this new drug prosecution cooperative program. You don't make any reference to prosecutions for alien smuggling. What can you tell us about the impact underway or the impact you anticipate from these two cooperative programs? Is there reason to believe the Mexican authorities are able and willing to accelerate prosecutions? What kind of specific report can you give us?
I can tell you that the initial results are very promising here. In less than a year, we've gone from having no pilot programs addressing drug prosecutions on the Mexican side to two, and we're in active discussions with the federal prosecutor's office about expanding it. The basic idea is simply this, that we have a number of drug offenses that occur on our side of the border, particularly at ports of entry, that for a variety of reasons ICE is able to investigate with assistance from CBP, but are not accepted for prosecution, and that Mexican federal law provides fairly significant penalties for that conduct, reaches that conduct, assuming Mexicans were involved, and the Mexican standards of proof are different and allow prosecution in certain instances where we can't do it. So it makes a lot of sense, and so far so good. And we've done the same thing with smuggling offenses for quite some time now through OASIS. I'm cautiously optimistic that we're going to stop really considering these as pilots and move to a broad-based prosecution program hand-in-hand with the Mexicans for low-level offenses involving Mexicans on their side. And as we've seen, they're starting to convict people and send them to jail.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, by every account, public and private, the threat on that border is increasing. The violence is increasing. The audacity of the and the bravado of the criminal cartels is growing by the minute. According to Department of Justice's most recent National Drug Threat Assessment, released in February of this year, the cartels are not only, quote, the single greatest trafficking threat to the United States, quote, they also have operations in every region of the U.S. and are expanding into more rural and suburban areas, according to the CNN reports. And the cartels, according to that report, have partnered with U.S. street gangs and prison gangs for drug distribution to such an extent that, quote, Mexican drug trafficking organizations control most of the wholesale cocaine, heroin, and methamphetamine distribution in the United States, as well as much of the marijuana distribution, end of quote. Do you agree with that, Commissioner?
Yes, sir.
The report also says that greater levels of heroin, marijuana, and methamphetamine are flowing across the border than ever before and projects availability of such drugs to increase. Have I understated the threat that is there on the border?
I think not, Mr. Rogers.
Then how can you justify coming here to this Congress and asking us to decrease the amount of money and personnel in Border Patrol faced with this ever-growing threat to our security? How can you justify that?
Congressman, with regard to the fiscal year 2011 request and the level of Border Patrol agents, we've seen a remarkable growth thanks to this committee, and that growth will continue to increase. While we saw a slight decrease from 09 to 2010, from 20,294, 21,294 CBP officers, including and 20,019 Border Patrol agents, we will maintain a level 20,163 over 2011. So, in fact, with regard to the Border Patrol, the budget calls for a maintenance of the unprecedented levels that this committee has been instrumental in providing us on the southern border.
Well, you're still cutting air and marine operations, right? And Coast Guard.
The cut in air interdiction agents, but not a diminution in the assets, yes, is from 891 to 839 under the budget that has been called.
And when you furnished us the first iteration of your budget request for 2011, you would have cut 1,100 Border Patrol agents. Now, some of us rate, I'm sorry, 1,100 Coast Guard personnel. And then when you heard the noise up here against that kind of a cut, you came back with a budget request that restored some of that personnel, but you're still cutting the air and marine operations and other aspects. And I just wonder how in the dickens you can justify that given the threat that we're facing there by all accounts, including your own. Mr. Morton, you've been silent there a while. What do you say?
ICE's budget has a modest 2% increase, and our budget for this year annualizes the enhancement that we received in FY 2010. So I'm quite confident that the President's budget is going to sustain us at our highest levels ever, and we'll have a modest increase.
You know, Mr. Chairman, the old-fashioned idea of what Border Patrol and ICE is supposed to do is to protect us against the traditional threat along the border, illegal aliens particularly. But it's if the problem on the border has evolved into huge changes and into a huge danger, and that is criminality, drugs, and contraband, and that sort of thing, which is really a law enforcement problem. And I've been long critical of the administration, the previous one and this one, for not recognizing that the border is more of a criminal problem than it is now than it is anything else. And yet we do not have enough of the nation's law enforcement manpower on that border. I'm talking FBI, DEA, and those agencies that fight drugs and criminality. And this thing's getting out of hand down there. And I wonder what either of you see that we could be doing that we've not thought about or not planned for yet. Are we doing all that we can do? Commissioner?
There are always, Congressman, improvements that can be made, but in terms of the strategy and the resourcing of that that's taken place over the last decade, indeed over the last 5 years, I think what we do is we continue to get better and improve the mix and the alignment of the resources that have been provided. 20,000 Border Patrol agents compares favorably to what existed when I first met you 15 years ago by a factor of almost six. We've seen dramatic increases, and we need to now develop the capacity of these wonderful men and women who now serve as journeymen, will have the opportunity to become journeymen Border Patrol agents. We need to build on intelligence sharing. We need to build on technology that's available. We need to coordinate with our sister and agencies like ICE in a more effective way. All of this is always a work in progress. So I wouldn't for a moment suggest that the work is done or the challenges aren't supreme. They are. But in fact, we stand better resourced than we've been. And we need to develop and see that the resources that have been given to us are deployed most effectively and aligned with our technical equipment and capacities that also are, frankly, unparalleled from what existed in the past.
Senator Morton.
Yeah, two quick things, Mr. Rogers. One, on your point about the border is facing a level of criminality that needs to be reflected in a sort of change in strategy and approach. I think that's one of the sort of great promises that ICE holds. As you sort of alluded to, traditionally we're often thought of in the context of civil immigration enforcement, yet at the same time we are the second largest criminal investigative agency with nearly 7,000 special agents, 1811s, whose sole job is to investigate crime. And we need to harness both of those powers in a very focused way on the border to address the problems you've arisen. And in terms of what can we do better, one of the things you mentioned earlier on the report, that same report from the Department of Justice that pointed out the relationship between the cartels and gang members and street-level distributions, we did something differently this year, and it was the first time we've ever done it, and we need to do more of it. And that's ICE does a lot of transnational gang removal. We've typically done it in terms of, look at MS-13, look at this gang. Are they here unlawfully? Let's remove the gang members from the community from just a general public safety perspective. For the first time, we took the very report you were talking about, and we said, well, this time let's focus on those gangs that also have a direct connection to the cartels and the distribution of narcotics. And we did it nationwide. And we ended up with nearly 800 people. And that's the kind of thing where we need to match our civil powers with our criminal powers in a coordinated way so that we're not just removing gang members, we're removing gang members who are furthering the efforts of specific cartels. And we're going to do more of it.
I know my time is about expired. Can I ask just one brief question?
Certainly.
And it relates to the gangs, the contract killers that the cartels are now engaging, have contracted with, that are apparently responsible for thousands of murders on both sides of the border. What can you tell us, either of you, about what we're doing to try to break that cycle of hiring gang killers?
I'm not familiar with the level of contract killings that particular report refers to. I will say this, and I'd prefer to say more about it in private rather than in public. The relationship between ICE and DEA is the closest it's ever been in our country's history. And I don't want to suggest that it's perfect. We can always work to make it better. But there is a lot going on in that regard that I think is promising. We need to do the same with FBI. ICE's role from a border security perspective with FBI has been good, but not particularly strategic, and so I need to work on that some more.
Well,
that area might be a fruitful one.
The Washington Post of April 4th carried the story about the heavily tattooed Barrio Azteca gang, long operating across the border in El Paso, dealing drugs, stealing cars. But in Juarez, that organization, according to this report, now specializes in contract killing for the Juarez drug cartel. And according to U.S. law enforcement, it may have been involved in as many as half of the 2,600 murders in the city in the past year alone, and that's just one town, one city. Can you follow up on that and give us a report?
Be happy to.
Thank you. Mr. Rodriguez.
Thank you very much, and let me thank you for being here with us today and what you do for all of us throughout the country and keeping us safe. Commissioner and Mr. Secretary, as you well know, I represent one of the largest districts in the nation. I have 785 miles along the border. I have 17 border stations. I have 7 ports of entries and crossings. I have 3 border patrol sectors. And I want to take this opportunity to invite both of you to come to my district if I can, okay? I've had Secretary Salazar from the Interior come by and visit. I have two beautiful national parks right on the border, the Amistad, which is the best bass fishing in North America, as well as the Big Bend area, which is a beautiful area that has 340,000 people visited every single year. And I have 1.7 million people visit the Amistad, and thank God we've never had any serious incidents there. But we do have a very beautiful relationship in those communities, working with the Border Patrol as well as the park rangers, and working together in housing and working on that. But I wanted to follow up, and I've been told that that we're safer when we communicate with the other side and have lines of communication. There was a numerous number of crossings that were closed in that sector, from Del Rio to Presidio is some 400 miles, and there's communities there that no longer have legal crossings anymore. And so, do you see any value with having border crossings within the Big Bend, or at least looking at the feasibility of reopening some of the old crossings?
Congressman Rodriguez, I thank you for that invitation. I've been to your district and share your assessment of Amistad and the Big Bend National Park. And as you point out, in those vast expanses of the Big Bend country in Texas, across from Nuevo León and Tamaulipas and Coahuila, there is a border that we need to protect. But also a border that serves as the community, a cross-border community of families, friends, as well as commercial partners. In the wake of security threats, and security being paramount, there have been, as you noted, closings of a number of the so-called informal crossings in which people crossed back and forth across Rio Bravo, Rio Grande, for generations. As a result of your inquiries and your requests, and without sacrificing security, which we understand understand that needs to be one of the primary requirements, we are in the process of reviewing the feasibility of opening one or more of those crossings, but doing it in a controlled way. I think it is beyond the point in American and border history where we can have unmonitored and uncontrolled crossings. But the point you make about facilitating cross-border community life is one that we understand and will work to assess with your office.
Thank you very much. And I just want to highlight a very positive thing that's occurring in the Big Bend with the ones we call the Diablos. And it's about 38 or so Mexicans that legally and I say legally every year during our emergency periods of time when we have fires in our national parks that have been trained to help us. And they come every year in those specific areas where we have serious fires occur, where we can't get other people there as quickly as possible. And it's beautiful the way they go out there right now. They just go out to the border and yell out, and these farmers and ranchers on the Mexican side come riding their horses and get into their gear to fight the fires on our side. And so there's some beautiful stories to tell about that. So I want to thank you for that. And we want to continue to enhance that beautiful trade that occurs there, not to mention the tourism with the national parks of those figures that I mentioned. Secondly, if I can, real quickly, I know that throughout our history we've used the military on the border, and and they have played a very significant role in certain specific areas. The National Guard, for example, perform non-law law enforcement duties and allow for more of our trained Border Patrol and Customs to be able to do some of the things that they can do, you know, and get out of the behind the desk. The military on the border has been also a serious source of contention along the border. As you well know, in 97, an incident with a young man, a kid, actually, a high school kid in my district at Redford, who got killed. And I wanted to just get some assurance from you. I know the governor has talked about sending the troops to the border. And by the way, I don't have any problem if that's what we need to do. But I want some assurance that before any type of action in this manner is taken, that there will be appropriate outreach and information to my communities, the ranchers out there, and the people in that area, and be notified if that's the case.
Congressman, in dealing with the violence, real and threatened, the administration is determined to take all necessary actions to protect border communities and our national borders. In that inquiry, all options have been on the table and will be on the table, both in terms of law enforcement, and any action that's taken will involve the kind of outreach with local communities and with state authorities, as you suggest.
Thank you. If I can just add, I know I have my ranchers who also enjoy hunting and that kind of thing, and I don't want them in any endangered by our own troops when they go. So that communication is essential. Thank you.
Mr. Calvert.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, gentlemen, for attending today. And as Mr. Rogers pointed out, the level of violence is continuing to escalate. I live down in Southern California, and we see evidence of that every day in our communities in California, and I'm sure throughout the Southwest United States. And obviously, the violence in Mexico is extreme. I would say it's not a fight, it's a war. Almost 23,000 people have been killed just since 2006 alone in Mexico. And I certainly congratulate Calderon and the courage he's taken in taking this adversary on, and it is an adversary. And as has been pointed out, the violence is escalating on both sides of the border. Not just the media when they point out what happened to this rancher in Arizona, but the drug activity throughout the United States, especially methamphetamine, which is being distributed through these gangs. Right here in Virginia and Maryland. It's not just California in the Southwest. It has spread throughout the United States. And because of this level, I want to kind of go over what the gentleman from Texas, as you know, we had an operation called Operation Jumpstart. I was along the border back in 2006. And they gave the assistance to the Border Patrol as they were increasing their numbers to protect that border. But obviously since then, violence has increased significantly on the Mexican side and on the American side of the border. So I'm going to ask, do you think that if that's occurring, do you see any value in another deployment of the National Guard along the border to support your mission until we can stabilize this, especially in areas next to Juarez or Laredo and other areas where we seem to see real extreme problems along that that area.
Congressman, as we confront the violence on our side of the border, and particularly the, as you point out, the extreme levels of violence taking place in northern Mexico, in Juarez, but also increasingly in the northeast in Nuevo Laredo and the Tamaulipas area. As I said, the administration is committed to considering all options and the mix of options in order to deal with this threat and to contain and to see to it that the kind of extreme violence that's being experienced in Mexico in single incidents does not come over into the United States and affect our communities on the border. What I would say is that, as I said to Congressman Rodriguez, all options are on the table in the process of being considered and will be determined in terms of law enforcement, National Guard deployment, if any, in the near future.
The reason I point that out, if in fact the reports that I've read in other areas is that that the president of Mexico is going to escalate here rapidly his battle, it seems that that he's been doing that, but I understand he's going to do significant escalation here soon. Going after these individuals throughout Mexico, that this probably will have an effect in the United States, especially in the border communities, and whether we should be prepared for that if, in fact, that occurs. And, Mr. Morton, on your comment about deporting these criminal aliens that are in the United States, I would hope as rapidly as possible, identifying these individuals, especially the ones that are involved in distribution of drugs throughout the United States, identifying, finding them and deporting them as quickly as possible, and I would hope that's a top priority in your department.
Well, absolutely, and actually the chairman referred in his opening remarks to whether or not our relationship with Mexico has improved, and that's one area where it actually has improved quite dramatically. The commissioner and I went with the secretaries to Mexico, and one of the agreements we signed was to provide information sharing between ICE and Mexican law enforcement officials on all of the criminals that we're removing, with an eye to streamlining that process. We are working with them on having more centralized removal procedures for criminals, maybe flying them to central places. We don't just take them to the border communities anymore. It's a top priority.
And I would hope if they're incarcerated, they stay incarcerated. I don't have a lot of confidence sometimes in the penal system in Mexico, but nonetheless, it seems I have a lot of leakage. One other issue before my time expires. AMOC is in my congressional district in Southern California. And as you know, they've been very successful and very integral in protecting our country from attack, not just from drug activity, but any potential terrorist problem and the rest. Could you provide an update on how AMOC in Riverside, California, is utilized specifically in their interdiction, security, and coordination roles as the environment on and across the border has changed over the last year? And I certainly share Mr. Rogers' perspective on this is, if any time, this is more important than ever to keep this type of program rolling. So with that,
Mr. Calvert, I share your enthusiasm for AMOC in Riverside. Tony Crowder and his colleagues at the Operations Center have built a very critical a capacity to monitor movements, aviation movements in the country and across the border, in a way that significantly enhances our situational awareness with regard to aviation efforts in particular to bring dangerous things and potentially dangerous people into our country. There is a continued reliance and integration of AMOC into our national military, civilian, that is between the military, FAA, operating in a coordinated fashion with AMOC, and that the value of that asset is recognized and supported by Secretary Napolitano significantly.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Farr.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've been It's interesting testimony on the border because you led our committee on a CODEL once to from Tucson to San Diego, and I was thinking as we've listening to a lot of this, perhaps we ought to do it before it gets too hot, some one-week-long weekend here, do a CODEL from El Paso Juarez to the whatever that city is at the no the other way, go east, go the rest of Texas, Brownville. But I I'm struck here as I listen to this because it seems to me that we've got to think a little bit outside the box. A lot of testimony in other committees is what are we doing in Iraq and Afghanistan. If you think about it, we're trying to stabilize an area. We're trying to put a lot of foreign aid into that so that we can stop the violence that is caused by the Taliban. And we have the same situation on the border. We just have different names for it. And instead of the military, we put the ICE border patrol. And I'm not sure we've even focused on what we ought to be doing about infrastructure development, particularly foreign aid to build the Mexican side of the border up so that all the pain isn't on our side. Because I think just like the military said that we can't win the war in Afghanistan militarily, I don't think we can arrest our way out of our border issues. And I say that because I represent Salinas, California, which is not on the border, but it's halfway between Northern California and Southern California, and we have a border war going on in Salinas between the Norteños and Sorteños. And last year they killed 29 kids. Kids killed kids. 29 in a small town. Just think what that would be. And it's got everybody absolutely freaked. And last 2 weeks ago, kid got up in the middle of the night to go out to get a drink of water, and he got killed by a bullet. It was a stray bullet. He wasn't intended. It's just the wrong place, wrong time. 5 years old. Could have been anybody's child. And it's brought this city to the knees. And so I'm thinking that we really need to have a more of a collaborative because, and I want to ask some questions of Secretary Morton. And by the way, Commissioner, I'm really pleased with your background in both in San Diego, knowing the border issues, but your background in education. Because I think what we need to start looking at in education, they know that you can't put all of the resources in the schools and expect them to have kids not drop out unless you have what they call wraparound, all those other social services in a community. And you know that from on an airport district in San Diego. It wasn't an island within the city. It had to have collaboratives with everything. And I think you're building those collaboratives, but I don't think we're building them enough. And I wanted to ask Secretary Morton, we've had this testimony before this committee about the cooperation with alcohol, tobacco, and firearms, AFT. But it's obvious that there's still a massive number of guns and other weapons recovered by raids by Mexican authorities, as well as ongoing levels of violence that U.S. has still not successfully reduced in the southbound flow of arms. And my understanding is that some of ICE's resources have been redirected to assist in reducing the flow of guns. And what I wanted to, the questions I have is, what role does ICE play in reducing the southbound flow? What do you see as the central challenge to eliminating the illegal flow of arms? What are the problems is ICE facing? And if you were given the authority and the responsibility, how would you execute a program to eliminate the southbound flow of guns? And the reason I ask that is when I went with the president to the Summit of Americas, we stopped in Mexico City. And it was your folks in your department that were asking these questions of me about they're not seeing the kind of collaboration that they wanted to see with AFT. So perhaps you can answer that question today.
Well, here's what we do now. Your question suggested, we do not have...
It's not what you're doing now. It's what you can do, well, what you can do and reduce.
Well, let me tell you...
What's not and what you're not doing that you should be doing or would like...
We have no, by statute, we have no FFL authority.
I know that. But you have collaborations now.
That's right. So the support that we can bring is... to ATF in in a support role. We also do have independent authority to investigate smuggling of firearms in violation of law, but we have no authority to oversee or go to FFLs. And then we work very closely with CBP to target specific shipments, and often a CBP interdiction at the border is in fact based on ICE intelligence that we develop through an investigation, and then we refer it to CBP for actual arrest and interdiction at the border. And we're doing everything we can to play the most significant support role we can to ATF and to CBP, and where we have evidence of smuggling, an actual smuggling network, we'll do that independently, but we are quite limited in our legal authority to do more.
I know you're limited in your legal authority, and that's what my question really went to, is if you were given authority, sole authority, because I've even been told that there's restrictions on what AFT can do, very restrictive as to what they can do in gun stores and so on. If you had, we were rewriting all this, what would you like to see?
Well, I think one of the big challenges that we face right now are, you know, the southbound inspection process, harnessing more and more of that as CBP does more and more southbound inspection, taking our intelligence, matching it up with CBP's powers to inspect, and, you know, doing a more aggressive approach on searches along the border, and not just in a random way, but ones that we have developed intelligence from our office in Mexico and our offices along the border of, look in that car, look in that container. We're in our infancy on that, but that's what we're doing. And the more we have a very broad informant network, we have a lot of undercover cases, we have a lot of cooperators, harnessing that power, again, within our limitations of the law that we have, to direct more seizures. And the other piece is working much more closely with the Mexicans, because they seize quite a large number of firearms on their side of the border, far more than we interdict right now going across.
Does the power, the agricultural inspections from the Mexican side, greater for CBP than the firearms power on our side? You can go to do more inspections of where it's coming from, source of an issue.
No, CBP's powers of inspection are quite broad and expansive on the border. It's more of a question of the infrastructure and how it was originally designed and put together. In the beginning, the structure was mainly on inbound inspection.
Mm-hmm.
And here we're talking about outbound inspection, and just the challenge, literally the infrastructure challenges for CBP of doing outbound inspections in a facility that was designed with all the lanes and the inspection booths for the inbound. And CBP's been working on that, and we have been lending a lot of our, we do surge operations hand-in-hand, primarily through our best task forces with CBP, where we literally go into the outbound lanes, surge, and start checking on individual trunks. It's not so much that CBP doesn't have the power, it's that it's building up that southbound inspection capacity.
Thank you. Mr. Carter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank both of you for being willing to take on this tough job, and it's a tough one. I personally am very frustrated with this whole operation. I've been involved in looking at the southwest border as a member of Congress and on a committee that can do something about it since 2004. We have dumped tons of resources into the border, and I see nothing but failure. I see we've gone from cartels in Colombia to now cartels within 250 miles of my home. I woke up Saturday and Sunday finding out that 23 houses in Austin, Texas were cartel-owned drug distribution houses. Good news is we raided them, I think made 17 arrests. But the point is, now it's no longer 250 miles from my house. Now it's 5 miles from my house. Okay? As far as I'm concerned, and as far as the people of Texas are concerned, this is an expanding potentially violent situation that is moving into our state. If there are 23 houses in Austin, Texas, there's probably 50 in San Antonio, and how many in San Diego, nobody knows. So the question is, this cancer is spreading. It's not stopping. Meanwhile, I talk to Border Patrol agents who are fired upon regularly from the Mexican side with no authority to return fire. We've got to at some time recognize that we have to actually get in the business of fighting these people and not just talking about fighting the people. And I want to know, how much assurance do you have that AKs are not going to be firing in the capital city of Texas, because we now know the drug cartels are purchasing property in Austin, Texas. So this looks like to me we are failing at that level. We have now seen this violence moved up to within 5 miles of my home. I want you to give me an answer on what do you see that we can do to start fighting rather than talking about fighting now for all the time that I've been in this committee? Any answer. I'll take any answer.
To say that, in part thanks to this committee, there are increased resources, and that, in fact, the potential for progress exists, is not to deny the gravity of the threat. In fact, as you suggest, when you deal with an issue in law enforcement, in particular in one area, it moves and pops up in another. So, in fact, we did see the movement of cartel power once the Medellin and Cali cartels were reduced in significance. We saw the growth of Mexican cartels, and we've seen the movement into the interior of the United States of drug distribution gangs that are geared and based in organized crime in Mexico. Having recognized that threat, in fact, we build the capacity to deal with it. And we separate out, the need to prevent the kind of mass violence that we've seen in places like Juarez and increasingly in Nuevo León and Tamaulipas from coming over in that form with that degree of shootout in public places that Mexico has experienced. We haven't seen that in the United States, and we need to do everything and intend to do everything that we must to prevent that. That's not to deny, as you say, that there are drug distribution rings in every medium and large size city in the United States, and those cause and have violent repercussions. That means that we need to continue to do the investigation, the prosecution, and the interdiction that takes place at greater levels in the past, but is challenged by significant threats. So I take your point, Mr. Carter, but I don't see this as unmitigated failure. I see it as a continuing challenge and the need to continue to ramp up our capacity and our willingness to stay the course on this.
Well, I was in the business of putting people in prison for this for 20 years, okay? I mean, I know there's always going to be and always have been drug distribution points. My point is, it's organized crime, Mexican cartel, that are out there buying homes and putting people in them. It means that they've got the resources and they've got the expansion to come as far as into Austin, Texas, which makes it mighty close to home for me. And I think that at some point in time, we got to recognize we got them out of Colombia. Why can't we get them out of Mexico? What did we do in Colombia that pushed them out of Colombia? I think that the Colombian government got severely involved, and we, under the Bush administration, forced them and pushed them and cajoled them and financed them to get those people shoved out of Colombia. But they shoved them right into Mexico. And now we need somehow to get together, and I have the greatest respect for the Mexican government. I went to school in Mexico. I believe that they are a first-class country with first-class resources, and we can assist those resources. But this is a fight. We can't just sit around and talk about it. I think if somebody fires upon an American who's doing his job on our side of the border, from the other side of the border, we should talk to Mexico about shooting back. And if we don't shoot back, what's all the Border Patrol could do is duck and cover.
Border Patrol agents have the right to engage in self-defense, and what we have is that's different from what has ever been the case is we have the potential, and in Arizona and Sonora, the reality of actually having federal police officers that coordinate with our Border Patrol that can actually deal with this. So, for example, in the Tucson-Sonora corridor, where the SSP has deployed 200 federal police officers who are in regular contact with our Border Patrol, we've seen a decrease in the rocking incidents and a response, a real-time response. In that respect, I see great potential in terms of the coordination. But your point in terms of protecting our Border Patrol agents, I take that point completely.
Well, these incidents took place at in the district at Laredo, across the border, across the river.
All right, thank you. Let's see, Mr. Roybal Allard.
Bersin, in the rush to build the border wall, there was a failure to address some of the very legitimate concerns of affected landowners. And the wall continues to negatively impact border communities by limiting the ability of first responders to reach isolated areas and by adversely affecting farms and other businesses. These stakeholders play a critical role in border security, and their views should be incorporated into CBP's planning process moving forward. Can you please tell us what steps is your agency taking to develop constructive relationships with local landowners to mitigate the effects of fencing and other security measures on border communities? And also, given the fact that in some areas, and I believe that El Paso is probably one of the best examples, public information offices have been established in certain sectors of the border to perform community outreach, and that they have proven to be a very effective means of facilitating dialogue and addressing local concerns before they become major problems. Are you also considering of expanding those programs?
Congresswoman, I believe with regard to each of our Border Patrol sectors, we have a public outreach and public affairs capacity locally. And one important improvement that's been made as I return after a hiatus of 10 years to see the Border Patrol and the way in which it's grown is that it has developed a significant and a sophisticated outreach capacity in terms of real communication to communities and the development of relationship with community groups, civic groups, business groups, in a way that simply was not the case. And you correctly point out it's absolutely essential in areas such as the building of the border fence that's taken place over the last number of years. Secretary Napolitano made clear when she came in, and as someone who's lived on the border for a very long time and been a political leader as well as a prosecutor, governor in Arizona, made clear that there would be this kind of outreach, and I think we continue to see it, for example, in the area of environmental mitigation, in which $50 million has been committed by CBP to the Department of the Interior. There is regular communication with the department with regard to environmental mitigation, and in fact, regular communication with local communities. There have been, I think, considerable improvement, recognizing that we can always be better in terms of public outreach and public communication. But I believe the extensiveness of the contact of CBP, and particularly the Border Patrol, having to do with the fence, is actually a fact and a very positive fact.
I raise this because there was a letter sent to Congresswoman Association of Landowners who feel that a lot more needs to be done. So I'm glad that you're paying attention to this issue, but I think you need to look into it to make sure that there is more progress made in that particular area. I also very quickly want to bring to your attention an issue that I've been concerned about for some time. And that is the reports that I continue to hear about the mistreatment of immigrants, especially unaccompanied children, at Border Patrol stations. And according to the human rights groups, these children sometimes go without beds or blankets, they fail to receive adequate nutrition, and in some cases have endured physical and emotional abuse. Can you please explain what steps that you're going to be taking to ensure that every individual in custody is treated humanely, and also to provide this committee with the policies and procedures governing their care, as well as if you could describe what oversight mechanisms exist to prevent the abuse of detained immigrants at Border Patrol facilities? I've asked this question before. I've gotten responses. I'm told that changes are being made. However, I continue to hear from advocacy groups that go into these facilities and hear complaints from immigrants about their treatment. So, again, this is an area that needs attention immediately, and there's a lot of work that needs to be done, especially in light of the fact that we are talking about young children here.
The commitment to humane and lawful treatment of all people taken into custody is a paramount one, and one that CBP takes seriously. As you know, for many, many years, the treatment of unaccompanied alien children has been governed by the Reno versus Flores settlement quite some time ago. And in fact, that sets the standard and the protocols which are required in this case. We have, and I've looked into this with regard to so-called UAC, the unaccompanied alien children. There are very established procedures that are followed and supervised with oversight to see to it that these minors are handled with extreme concern and care, and watched very carefully as they are turned over to ICE for then, I think, subsequent transfer to Health and Human Services. So there is a very established, long-established procedure for handling unaccompanied children, and one that I'm satisfied our people understand the absolute importance of observing, and to my knowledge are observing it.
Okay, could you please submit whatever those procedures are, and also I just want you to know that in private meetings with some Border Patrol, there does seem to be some confusion about what they can and can't do and how to go about it.
Before turning it over to Mr. Morton, let me say that to the extent that you you receive complaints in this area or any other for that matter, please forward the specific facts, and they will be looked into. And yes, we will provide you with the procedures that are required by Reno versus Flores,
as well as the oversight procedures that you have.
Just very quickly, Border Patrol's detention authority is quite limited, and it typically doesn't extend much past a few hours to 12.
And that's what I'm talking about, that 72-hour
the window, because in most instances, if there's going to be any prolonged detention, they are transferred to Immigration and Customs Authority. As you know, we've got a very pronounced overhaul of our immigration detention practices underway. But on the question of minors, there is quite a detailed set of procedures. They come to us, but only very briefly, because we, in turn, turn them over to Child Protection Services in most instances, or advocacy groups with contracts with the state.
Mr. Culberson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner Bersin, could I ask your help, please, in providing me with some information that my office has been trying to get from y'all for some time? It's very simple and straightforward. What we're looking for are the numbers of individuals that have been apprehended, this by sector by sector, on the southern border, number and northern border too, for that matter. I'm not neglecting it, but we're obviously the problem, the most severe problems on the southern border. But by sector, the number of individuals apprehended, and then the number of individuals actually prosecuted by sector over the last several fiscal years. Could you provide that to me by the end of the week? You've got the data, and it's real simple.
I was going to say I'd be happy to provide the data. My understanding is that we do have apprehension statistics, and we do have the prosecutions, particularly with regard to Streamline. The only hesitation is we'll get it to you as expeditiously as we can.
Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate it. We and all of us in this committee have a keen interest in making sure the border is secure. Those of us from Texas in particular, this is near and dear to us. My good friend Sewer Rodriguez, who we were elected together in 86 and known each other, been good friends ever since, have worked together very successfully with Henry Cuellar, who also was elected with us to the Texas House in 86 to implement Operation Streamline. It works beautifully. This is not complicated. You enforce existing law with existing resources by law enforcement officers who are using their good judgment and their good hearts to prosecute everybody who crosses, with the obvious exception, when the women and children, you know, are handled a little differently. The officers are using their good judgment, their good hearts. But I just wonder if you could reaffirm your support for Operation Streamline and our efforts to get it expanded up and down the southern border. You're in support of Streamline and want to see it expanded?
Yes. As a former prosecutor, I understand the importance of consequence delivery. As you understand, series of crimes, save the most heinous, actually are prosecuted at 100% rate.
Sure.
But the importance of the deterrent effect and the application of Streamline has a very important place in the consequence delivery.
Sure.
And the deterrence of illegal immigration, among other violations.
And you've seen the dramatic declines in the crime rate in the Del Rio and Laredo sector. It's just a terrific program. And in also, I think it's a it's important, as Mr. Carter has said, that I think we quit the country, recognize that there, in a real sense, where there's an undeclared war on the southern border. Mexico is as violent today, northern Mexico, as it was 100 years ago. I'm going to go back and look at the level of violence 100 years ago during the Mexican Revolution in northern Mexico and compare it to today, and I suspect we'll discover that the level of violence today is even more severe than it was 100 years ago when President Wilson sent General Pershing to the southern border to deal with the violence that had crossed over into the United States. The Mexican Army itself, I understand, Department of Defense estimates that the Mexican Army has about 130,000 troops, but that the cartels, just the two biggest cartels together, have about 100,000 foot soldiers. So in a very real sense, the level of violence, the spillover, the shootings across the border, helicopter crossings, just the chaos and the violence that we see in northern Mexico certainly meets, Webster's dictionary defines a state of war as a state of hostility, conflict, or antagonism between opposing forces for a particular end. And I certainly think what we're seeing in Mexico today qualifies as a state of war, which we need to quit. We need to, as Mr. Carter says, there's a lot of talk and we don't see enough action. So I appreciate your commitment to expanding Operation Streamline. That's vitally important. It works beautifully. This is, from our perspective on the U.S. side, a law enforcement operation. We need to stay focused on that. The role that the National Guard played in the Bush administration was one of support, and support of the Border Patrol, and I think that's important. But they were very successful where they were deployed, and sincerely appreciate the dedication of your officers, the work that you're doing. I understand the frustrations and the challenges you face. I know this committee supports you in a bipartisan way. I would like you to, if you could, look into the what Mr. Carter has identified in the Laredo sector, several instances that I'm also aware of shootings, people from the Mexican side shooting at our law enforcement officers, and our law enforcement officers are unable to return fire. They're under orders not to return fire, and that just doesn't make any sense. They can certainly shoot in self-defense, but I hope that you can correct that situation.
Culbertson, we will get back to you with the incidents that have occurred over the last 3 years and the facts attendant to each of them, because I think the protection of our Border Patrol agents on the front line is very much uppermost in my mind.
If I also want to ask, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the time. The Border Patrol in fiscal year 2008, Commissioner Bersin, reported that there were three individuals, and this is from the GAO report in August, that the Border Patrol reported in fiscal year 2008, there were three individuals encountered by the Border Patrol at Southwest border checkpoints who were identified as persons linked to terrorism. Who were they, and to what terrorist organizations were they linked?
I prefer to get that back to you in response to that issue. I can't identify those persons for you at this moment.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Ruffin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner Bersin, Secretary Morton, thank you for being here. I come from a non-Mexican border state of New Jersey, but there are consequences to the flow of criminal activity across the Mexican border into the United States that are felt in New Jersey in terms of gang violence and drugs, of course. In many of my town hall meetings, the subject of illegal immigration comes up, especially across that immigration originating across the Mexican border. The issue of a fence, some people say, just build a fence all the way across the border. I notice in the budget we now have, in the testimony of Commissioner Bersin, 646 miles of fencing to go up to 655 miles. Of fencing. Do you consider that amount to be sufficient? Should the entire border be, should a fence be put up through the whole border? Would that be the best use of U.S. taxpayer dollars to stop the flow of illegal activity across the border?
The building of more than 600 miles of fencing in the original directions of the Congress, as Secretary Napolitano indicated when she took office more than a year ago, as she committed to completing what Congress had mandated, and with some several miles that are continued to be discussed, that commitment has been met. The Secretary has also indicated that she will continue to be advised by professionals on the border. Border Patrol agents, our field officers, our Air and Marine officers, as well as ICE agents and others who live and work on the border, about whether or not any additional infrastructure would be necessary.
Mr. Commissioner, excuse me, I have a limited amount of time, and so I want to follow up on your answer. So would it be a fair characterization of your testimony that today and in the fiscal year 2011 budget request of your agency, you the amount of fencing that you want to build is being funded?
To this date, yes, sir.
Okay. Next, there is a general sense, and this is a softball. This is one right over the middle for you gentlemen to address. But there is some chatter out there from various sources saying that the border between Mexico and the U.S. is porous, it's practically open, there are criminal gangs just flowing unimpeded into the United States, drugs are coming in willy-nilly. Now, of course, your written testimony belies that, but for the record, and this is being televised, are those statements true? Illegal immigrants coming in, terrorists practically able to walk in without any problem?
those statements aren't true, as your question suggests.
They're true that all these things are happening easily without any impediments?
No, I think that both Commissioner and Bersin and I would note for everyone here, and I think most of the individuals on the panel have seen it as well. While the challenge remains very significant, and I don't pretend that it's not a very real and significant challenge, the resources and enforcement dedicated to our southwest border has never been greater, and it is, the change is profound in the 16, 17 years I've been in the enforcement business.
But, sir, Mr. Secretary, is it enough? I appreciate the fact that there are more resources than ever. The threats are real, and you're addressing them with greater and greater success. is your budget enough? Should we give you more money to do more things?
Well, you know, that's a question that administration officials always have to dance a little bit on, and so I'll say that I'm always happy to do everything I can with the good money that the Appropriations Committee gives me.
Well, are we gaining ground or are we losing ground in these areas?
I think we're gaining ground, but again, I don't want to be heard as saying that I think we have by any means solved the problem or that some of the points that Mr. Carter has made. I think the greater point is that we are in a long-term struggle with organized criminals, and they're trying to stay a step ahead of us. They're willing to go to lengths that we haven't seen in the past. They're willing to go to a level of violence and brutality that we haven't seen in the past. And our job is to stay yet a step ahead of them. And
your budget
so
reflects the resources to address that, you feel, this year?
I feel that this year, for ICE in particular, we're going to have the
one,
most
one fast question
we've ever had.
Apparently,
gentlemen's time's expired. We'll
thank you, Mr.
We'll
Chairman.
We will have a quick second round, but let me turn to Mr. Mullahan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Bersin, there was a ABC World News Tonight report, it's a year ago now, which suggested that the title was Cocaine Highways, Post-NAFTA, Most Drugs Cross the U.S. Borders in Trucks. I don't know if you're familiar with that report or not, but let me read the introductory paragraph. It says, most of the drug shipments smuggled into the United States by the Mexican cartels are hidden in trucks that drive across U.S. border checkpoints in plain sight with little fear of inspection, U.S. law enforcement officials told ABC News. Only about 5% of the trucks coming into the country from Mexico are inspected, according to U.S. officials, and that's out of 3 million loaded container trailers crossing the border checkpoints last year, which would have been 08. And Juan Zarate is quoted in this piece as saying, quote, it is just, and Mr. Zarate dealt with these trafficking issues in President Bush's White House. Mr. Zarate was the Deputy National Security Director under President Bush. And he's quoted in this article as saying, it is just too costly and too slow, given the volume of trucks, to actually try to stop and inspect each and every truck. And he goes on and says that any attempt to inspect all trucks crossing the border, quote, would have a hugely negative impact in terms of commercial traffic and trade between the United States and Mexico. Is this accurate? Is this an accurate depiction of?
I'm not familiar with that particular article.
But are the facts
in
it?
I would not
resonate with you.
That the article, as you've described it adequately or accurately in all respects, characterizes the situation at the southern border.
I'm sorry.
So
what did you say at the beginning? Are you saying it does or it doesn't?
It does not. It does not, because in fact there are sophisticated methods by which we make the judgment about which of the trucks or vehicles that are coming across the border need to be inspected, subjected to the kind of X-ray equipment that's unprecedented, in part because of the contributions, the resources provided by this committee. But in fact, there is a higher percentage than 5% that are inspected, but it is not just sometimes it's done on a random basis, but in fact, there is a very much a sophisticated targeting system based on information available to us in terms of the advance information that we require of trucks coming to the border. In terms of the use of intelligence systems that we have, so that in fact it is much more organized, much more systematic, and much more effective than that article suggests, sir.
It sounds like you're dealing with a tough problem. I mean, the statistics can't be too far. Are there 3 million trucks that come across the border inbound to the United States every year from there?
I know we have 60,000 containers in terms of air, sea, and truck that come across every day that CBP handles. We don't have, I will get you the specific number of trucks breaking out of that.
It sounds like a huge number of trucks coming across the border, and it sounds like a small percentage, relatively small. Your response to that is, it may be relatively small, 5% might not be the right number,
but it might be relatively small, but we deal with that by a sophisticated selection process.
There are a variety of programs that help us distinguish between those cargoes about which we know something from those about which we
Would you, for the record, submit a kind of a discussion of this? Because I'm not going to have time to, you're not going to have time, response on my time. And I really think it's an important question. How do we deal with that? And if it's true, once they get across the border, my goodness, what a transportation vehicle for drugs across the country. And this article goes on to say that there is a, you know, they have hubs across the nation, and it references Atlanta doing it. For the record, would you please elaborate on this answer and get us some accurate statistics and then how you're dealing with it, please? And would you submit to my office that copy too? Mr. Chairman?
Thank you very much. We are trying to honor Mr. Burson's schedule for an airline that's not going to wait, but we do have time, and we'll and I think we do have some further questions. So we'll proceed with a brief second round here, if that's all right with you gentlemen. And I'll begin by referencing Mr. Rogers's comments about the. These gangs that have begun to specialize in assassinations. The Aztecas, I think, was the case he quoted, responsible for something like 2,660 Juarez murders in 2009. Just an incredible and of course, highly alarming figure. In that context, I'd like to ask you specifically about press reports that followed the March 13th killings of U.S. consulate workers and their family. The DEA led a multi-agency gang sweep called Operation Knockdown to apprehend dangerous Azteca gang members after that. Soon after, there was a warning that came out of DHS. That's what I want to ask you about. A warning that said that the Aztecas had been given, quote, a green light to conduct retaliatory killings of U.S. law enforcement officers. What can you tell us about that? It sounds like an ominous escalation. Looks like a type of direct confrontation that could mark a new level of engagement with these with Mexican gangs.
I would, to be candid with you, Mr. Chairman, I'd prefer to answer that question off the record with you, but what I can say more generally on that is that we have we're working very closely with DEA and FBI, not only in Operation Knockdown, but to identify the killers in that case and to focus the full weight and resources of the federal government on the Barrio Aztecas. We get a lot of information in through the investigation. So far, we have not seen that particular information that you refer to, in fact, reflects actual intentions.
Well, we of course would welcome the information you have in whatever setting you need to use. This was a public pronouncement, though. A green light on retaliatory killings of U.S. law enforcement officers, and that's why I bring it up in this setting. Very, very ominous kind of escalation of this. All right, let me turn to the Border Enforcement Security Task Force teams. You've referenced those a number of times today. I want to ask you more specifically about what value added they represent, and what kind of evidence you have of their performance, and also why this isn't more explicitly reflected in the budget request for 2011. We provided $100 million last spring to respond to the drug violence in Mexico. ICE received $55 million of this, largely for these new so-called BEST teams, as well as more border intelligence officers, expanded investigatory resources, and so on. Do you have any measure of success, Secretary Morton? What kind of difference are these units making? What is their value added? What what's your measure of success? What do you and what do you anticipate? We know that the 2011 budget request continues the base budget for ICE Southwest Border Initiatives like BEST. There's no specific funding proposed for expansion of this effort, and so just raises the question, is a flat budget adequate for what appears to be a problem that's not going away, and we hope an initiative that is making some headway?
A few things, Mr. Chairman. First, I think our budget does, in fact, request a modest increase for the BESS, and there being three new ones. They would not be along the southwest border. They would be at two seaports and one along the northern border.
Excuse me. Can you clarify that? There are... All right. There is some BEST team expansion, but not on the southwest
border.
Not
on the southwest border.
Is that true?
More generally, and I think that is a reflection, Mr. Chairman, in a very tight budget environment, that our modest increase would, in fact, focus there is how much importance we give to these task forces. Very quickly, the whole task force concept was for BEST was in response to the violence in Laredo. In 2005, very similar to the conversation that we've had today. And that worked so well that we immediately adopted the basic concept elsewhere, and it's grown very rapidly. We use them for all sorts of things, from criminal investigation to surge operations that we do with CBP. CBP is our biggest partner on the task forces. And we've begun to work very closely with the marshals. We're hunting down fugitives. We've returned a number of wanted murderers using the task forces. We go out and we find them, and we return them to Mexico. What do we need to do a better job on? We now have, were Congress to appropriate the 2011 budget, we would move to 20. I have directed that we create office here in headquarters to better coordinate what we're doing, to make sure that the task forces are working in tandem in their respective spheres, and that we have articulable measurements for success, so that you, the committee, can evaluate, the value added that we think they are, why we think they've been so successful. I'll tell you, they've worked really well in the seaport context. We're thinking about having our very first one at a major international airport. It just has worked well, bringing all of not only our federal law enforcement partners, but our local law enforcement partners. One little trick for us that we may want to talk to you about in terms of making the program a full success is our ability to reimburse some of our state and local law enforcement partners is quite limited. CBP has much broader authority, and we can reimburse some overtime, some equipment purchases, but it's quite narrow, and it's not really a question of money, but just authority for it, and I think that would greatly help the overall effectiveness of the BESS.
Have you, in fact, requested
we have not
that formally?
No, and we need to talk to you about it. It's really just... getting the legalities down in terms of our authorities. I don't think it's a heavy lift. It's something that we need to come and brief you about.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Rogers.
How many BESTs are on the southwest border?
10, Mr. Rogers.
The last time you were here, we talked about the advisability of creating a joint interagency task force for the whole southwest border. Where all of the agencies that might be involved in some fashion would be headquartered under one roof to coordinate the defense of that border, much the same as the JIATF task force in Florida manages the Caribbean anti-drug war very, very successfully.
Mm-hmm.
Are you giving some thought to that?
A lot of thought. I think your general, I think most people would agree with your general assessment that JIATF South has worked quite well, that something akin to JIATF South from an intelligence perspective makes a lot of sense along the southwest border. Mr. Bersin and I have talked about this subject at great length. And the question is, Do we model something like Jihad of South for the southwest border at a place like EPIC, which is right now very sort of DOJ and DEA centric, although CBP has quite a presence and ICE has quite a presence, or do we have an outright Jihad of structure that is independent of EPIC along the border? But I don't think few people would argue with your basic premise, both as to Jihad of South and as to whether something like that would be quite useful along the border. I think we think it does.
Well, we talked about this last year. Have you moved at all since then?
Well, I mean, yes, the we have talked about it a lot in the interdiction committee that both Mr. Bersin will now sit on and that I sit on presently. There are you know, many moving parts. Obviously, to do this right, you've got to get a lot of different federal agencies to come together under one roof and to coordinate. CBP and ICE, fortunately, were within the same department, and we're already moving a lot of our intelligence operations closer and closer together. I think the momentum, though, is very much in favor of the general concept that you outline, and it's just a matter of time.
Well, you know, we're facing problems on that border, as we've talked about this morning, that are enormous and growing and very dangerous to the security of the whole country, both us and Mexico. And it seems to me that we need a single place where all of the agencies, military and civilian, are headquartered, much like Jihad of South on the anti-drug war in the Caribbean, so that you can call instantly on any asset of any of these agencies that may or may not be needed and get an instant response, and where you coordinate both Justice Department activities as well as DHS and any and the military agencies. And when can we expect a decision about doing this?
I can't promise you any timetable on a decision, because it obviously involves many more players than me. What I can tell you is I actually spoke to Michelle Linhart, who's the acting administrator of DEA, on this very issue, this exact conversation, on the way back from the trip to Mexico, and we agreed that I would go down, and we were waiting for Commissioner Bersin to come on board, and go down and take a hard look at EPIC and what we're doing there, and we just need to have that kind of assessment and conversation among the key players, and now that Alan is here, that's very much one of the key players, and we'll move from there.
Could we get an update on your progress, say within 30 days? Is that a reasonable time, or should it be longer or shorter?
We can certainly give you an update on where the discussions on EPIC and the coordination among agencies is, but I think realistically, because this is, as you recognize, this would be a major structural transformation that, you know, it strikes me that 90, 120 days would give you more substance than not.
What could we expect in 90 days?
I think what we could report back to you is where the federal agencies across DHS and DOJ and DOD, for that matter, would be in terms of the willingness to entertain in serious detail, not in rhetorical flourish, the notion of a unified command, a joint command, or a variety of other command mechanisms that are available.
Mr. Chairman, to try to further this process along, I would hope that we could informally request of the gentleman a report on how we're doing in 90 days. Would that be a reasonable request?
Fine, from the two of us.
Let's just agree at this point that we will make that informal request and look forward to.
Well, that would be a big step forward. I think the time has come for a headquarters operation like this that to manage that whole aspect of the southwest border. Quickly, switching gears. Last time, I guess it was, you were here, Mr. Morton, Secretary Morton, we talked about the flow of drugs across the border this way and possibly the money and guns and stuff going the other way. What can you tell us about those subjects? First off, do we have an estimate, rough estimate, of the amount of money that the drug sales in this country are netting the cartels in Mexico?
Yeah, there are broad ranges of anywhere from $18 billion to north of 30.
$18 to $30 billion per year?
Per year.
And that's money going from the U.S. to the cartels across the border, southwest border?
Yes, and then on in certain instances to places like Colombia and other countries.
Yeah. How can that amount of money, say $30 billion, how can that amount of money cross that border without us knowing about it? I mean, that's just the bulk of that is something, is it not?
It is. If you were to ask me, where is the area where we need to devote more time and attention to developing intelligence, it is in this exact area that the while CBP and ICE's seizures, and we typically do these together because of a lot of CBP's seizures are based on ICE lead, are at an all-time high. The truth of the matter is we are not seizing but a fraction of those estimates, if that's right.
How much money have we seized going south?
Well, this has been a particularly good year. We're on our way. We typically, between the two agencies, are north of $200 million a year. This particular year, we had one of the largest seizures in ICE's history of $40 million in some shipping containers going between Mexico and Colombia that we found in the space of about 10 days that was packaged inside very large ammonium nitrate shipments.
But you've recovered roughly $200 million. Out of $30 billion.
Yes, and then DEA and the other partners at Justice sees a similar amount. But, again, it's by no means the majority of the money. We're not seizing most that is going south, if those estimates are right.
It's a minuscule percentage, a very minuscule percentage. Commissioner Bersin, do you have any info you can share with us on this?
Congressman, while much of the money goes down in bulk cash, as Secretary Morton indicated, and CBP and ICE are working to intercept it. Not all of it is bulk cash, but rather transferred through banking channels and through trade arrangements. And we need, as Mr. Morton suggested, we need a lot more intelligence about the way in which money is laundered, and we need to be able to identify with much more precision what the proportion is in cash as opposed to other kinds of transfers. And frankly, we need to get a better range than simply $18 million to $30 billion so that we can be much more responsive in our efforts.
Well, it seems like this is a very fertile field for getting at the problem, and that is tracking the cash that's flowing across that border in rivers.
Yeah, if I could just add one thing on that, Mr. Rogers, there are many things that we are doing to try to address that exact point. We are working with the DEA, ICE, CBP, and the Mexicans to study, what we are studying right now, the flow of money from the United States to Mexico. And we're also working with the World Customs Organization to try to broaden our efforts, and we're doing these for the first time, international bulk cash smuggling surges, where we get, last year we had over 80 countries pick a week, and we hit every airport, we hit every crossing, and we just go looking for trouble. And it's been quite successful. We want to do more of those under the umbrella of the WCO, and we've seized a lot of cash, and this phenomenon is by no means limited to the drug cartels. All large criminal organizations need to move money back and forth, and they do it through bulk cash smuggling or through sophisticated money laundering.
Now, at this committee some time back, there was a lot of noise made about weapons of the cartels coming from the U.S. across that border. Have you determined
how much weaponry is going north to south?
I have not, and as alluded to earlier, we have some we have very limited authority in the firearms area. Typically, we look to ATF for the estimates and analysis of what is coming and going across the border because they have the tracing authority.
Mr. Commissioner, do you have any info?
Not to add to that, sir.
Well, I can ask you. I can tell you this. According to CBP, no weapons have been seized by way of rail into Mexico from the U.S. Only 72 weapons have been seized heading outbound at points of entry, including one submachine gun, 15 shotguns, 28 rifles, and 28 handguns. Considering the weaponry that the cartels have in Mexico, these are pop guns that we're talking about here. There's hardly any weaponry that's been seized going south across that border. Is that generally true?
I know that our seizures are roughly in the neighborhood of about 1,500 a year. So, you know, most of the seizures that I'm aware of occurred in Mexico and obviously could have come from a variety of sources, including the southern border of Mexico and elsewhere.
No, I mean outbound weapons at points of entry.
I'd have to defer to Commissioner.
We did, let me say to the gentleman, we did receive, in response to inquiries in our last hearing, specific information about weapons seized at outbound points of entry. What we don't have is a fuller account of the assessment of weapons seized in the country, in Mexico, and the country of origin of those weapons.
That is an area of continued inquiry in terms of the population of weapons you look at, but the congressman is right. In fiscal year 2009, 109 firearms were seized by CBP, and thus far, to this point in this fiscal year, 72 firearms have been seized at outbound checks.
And those were the numbers that I quoted to you. But the question the chairman was talking about of the origin of weapons that have been found in Mexico, what can you tell us about those?
That's where ATF comes in and with the tracing.
That's the information we still need to get from ATF.
ICE does not have FFL authority under the law.
Yeah, we will pursue that energetically because we do need to fill out the picture more fully.
All right, thank you.
All right, moving right along. Mr. Rodriguez.
Thank you very much. And let me just say that in that specific area, I know we put in about 15, 17 million to do that, which is not sufficient, in all honesty. And the little reports that I got when I was in Mexico was that a good a number, they felt, came from the U.S., but they weren't sure. What they did know was that a lot of the guns did come from the wars that we've had in Central America and elsewhere, especially some of the big arms. But we do need additional data. I also feel what the Congressman, Minority Leader, just talked about in terms of following the money. We haven't done a good job there, and I know that there's some stuff out there in the Caribbean, and there's some other people doing some things. But please let us know in terms of what else we might be able to do there, because if it is $30 billion and that amount has remained stagnant, and we have done a lot more capture of a lot more drugs, and assuming that our appetite for drug in this country has remained the same, then we made some inroads. If our appetite has increased, then we haven't, you know, we're not there yet. But let me also just add that I just had an opportunity to visit 13 of my 20 counties. One of them was Fort Hancock, which is Husped County. And there's a genuine, of all my counties, I think that's where there's a genuine fear there that's occurring and a concern in terms of what's happening on the other side. I met with the sheriff's staff on this side. I met with the Border Patrol. And by the way, they're doing a tremendous job. All the numbers are dropping in my three sectors, and they're doing good work. And haven't heard too many complaints or too many concerns except in that specific area, and there's and that fear is you know, from other communities not wanting to send their kids to play ball there, to other things like that. And I know that part of it is just that what is what they hear in terms of what's occurring across the border and what's happening in terms of the ones that are coming across. There are increases locally in terms of they were telling me that they got about 1,100 seizures of you know, the local authorities there. And having said that, I wanted to reemphasize how important it is for us to continue to work with our sheriffs and the county officials as well as the cities. And I mentioned the city of Presidio because they have, I think, one deputy working there for the whole city. They can't afford any more. And so that Stone Garden project that the chairman has been really helpful on has been really a good program that has been extremely positive. And ironically enough, Husband County is not one of the ones that has received those resources. But, you know, but it has been helpful. So whatever we can do to beef up on local authorities and somehow look at the language and also look at the school districts, because I know I have a couple of school districts where they there's been talk about the people coming over and the kids that are dropping out, where there's a dialogue about picking up some of those kids to do the drugs now from the cartels. I don't have any evidence, but I know we've had a lot of, you know, talk in some areas in the border where it might be happening in Brownsville. Whatever we might do in terms of those political subdivisions, such as school districts, cities, and counties, and continue to support that, I would appreciate it. I know the administration, I think, that they wipe out that sector, out, you know, the $60 million that we put in there, Mr. Chairman. You know, it's in the budget? Not, okay. And because I know I'll be asking the chairman to see if we can up those numbers a little bit in helping out not only on the northern border but in the southern border. And so I wanted to, you know, stop with that and seeing how else we might be able to work with those communities. One or the other is just communication. Along that border there, my God, you get lost. You know, they're still unable to communicate among themselves. Having that interoperable communication capability is essential. And we're every year we put a little bit. In some areas we're almost there. In other areas we're not quite there yet. Where the local sheriff and local police can dialogue with not only with EMS but also Border Patrol and other people. That's important. And so, and thank you very much. You know, I don't know if you want to comment on that. You know.
Why don't we ask Mr. Mollahan to close us out, if that's all right, because our time is really drawing to a close. Mr. Mollahan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, Drug Enforcement Agency's 2011 request includes $40 million to dramatically expand the El Paso Intelligence Center. Part of the justification for that is the anticipation that ICE is going to be using that. Following up on the ranking minority members' questions, does ICE intend to choose EPIC as its primary intelligence center for Southwest border needs?
I was unaware that request was based in any formal way on a decision by ICE, because that decision hasn't been reached. What I have agreed to do is to take a hard look at the resources we do have at EPIC. I do think we need to have much more coordinated intelligence.
When are you going to make this decision? Because these funding decisions are going to be made very quickly, and it's a large amount of money. So the question is, does ICE support using EPIC as the primary intelligence center? And that's a question that really needs to be answered for us to respond to these requests from these law enforcement agencies.
And I think, as we've noted, that's an ongoing discussion and will be part of what we get back in 90 days that we've agreed to here.
Well, 90 days, I agree with the ranking member. 90 days is a long time because we're going to be making these funding decisions much more quickly than 90 days.
One thing I need to do is look at DEA's request for $40 million and you know, to the extent that it refers to ICE, that's news to me.
And then talk to Michelle about it. But I'm not prepared at this time to say that we have decided that, in fact, Epic is the place to be. It's obviously one of the prime contenders.
What would be the alternative to using Epic for that purpose?
One of the other centers, or the creation of a new center along the southwest border.
Who would stand the a new center up?
Well, it could be the Department of Homeland Security. CBP and ICE already are, in practical terms, the principal players along the border. CBP and ICE share intelligence regularly. We are already moving many of our operations. We do them in the same place. So there are other ability. And then, of course, the military is a key player. GADF South, to start with, has a very strong military support and structure to it.
Would you include my office, please, in the updates that Mr. Rogers has asked for this purpose?
Absolutely, sir.
I mean, we're making these decisions in real time. Is the reason that we're not...
Can I yield on that briefly?
Well, I don't have very much time here. May I yield after I'm finished?
Yeah.
Please, because if I can get one question here, I'm going to feel lucky. One more question. You know, that's a paltry number of weapons to seize going out of the country. Is that because you're not checking, you're not screening for traffic going out of the country? Then why wouldn't you catch more? Did you say 18 weapons going across the border into Mexico?
109 in the last fiscal year, but in fact we have not seized any weapons in rail, and yet every rail shipment in and out of the United States is subject to an X-ray examination. So
well, is it? Doesn't that my statistics? And I'm sorry to be so quick here and cut you off.
I
understand that's rude, and I don't want to do that, but I got to get the essence of my question. I understand that 90% of the firearms found in Mexico come from the United States. Do you agree or disagree with that statistic,
do
you have an answer?
I disagree with that. That is a statement that has been subject to, been broadly publicized, but does not reflect the reality. What has been, the most that could be said is that 90% of the weapons that have been traced may originate in the United States, but we don't know what the larger population of weapons are.
Can you give us a statistic of what percentage of the weapons being illegally used in Mexico come from the United States?
As Mr. Morton indicated, that's information, and we haven't dodged questions. That's information that's more readily available from ATF.
Well, they can't answer. I asked
and
them
it's
that
your
question.
Question that it's, I'm sure both of our committees have made this request, and we need to get.
Well, it sounds to me,
a better
Mr. Chairman, like we're not doing enough of screening, or focusing on at least effective screening on weapons traveling south. We screen a lot coming north, but maybe that's and not having enough time to. I won't make a judgment on that. Not having enough time to follow up the question. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Argus, you have a quick request for the record?
Just really quickly, I know that the State Department had also been looking in terms of the money expenditures that were going into Mexico, doing something, as it was discussed here, about some collaborative effort together in some area that includes the State Department and our efforts with Mexico, that a little bit over $1 billion. And hopefully maybe we can move that dialogue further into some reality in forming some center that will respond to that and address all those issues beyond not only security but what's also occurring in Mexico and the training of the judges and all that other stuff. Thank you.
Very briefly, Mr. Chairman, Chairman Mollahan, of course, will be important if we do a GIADF-like organization on the southwest border, because he appropriates the funds for the Justice Department. So I hear him saying that 90 days, if we delay the decision 90 days, it's going to be too late for the action of these subcommittees to write into the budget next year's money for such a center. Mr. Bersin.
Yeah, if I may say respectfully, I think that what we're talking about is such a remarkable institutional transformation that, in fact, that would not be a matter for this budget year in any case. While I agree that the issue on EPIC is improving its service to ICE and CBP as border agencies, we've made a huge investment in EPIC over the years, and I don't think in the next 90 days we can we're in a position to make a radical departure. But I take your point that we should be in a position to report in 90 days where the status of the discussion is, and if it's going further, then in fact it has real budgetary implications.
Well, just be advised that these subcommittees may override you and do this anyway.
Yeah.
Whether you like it or not.
I understand.
Or whether you've prepared for it or not.
But if you ask for my recommendation, I would not make a radical change in course in the period of time that we have to consider this. In this.
Well, with the severity of the problem on the border, a radical change may be in order.
In any case, the request stands for the 90-day report, as full as you can make it, of the state of your present thinking and interagency discussions. With that, we really have run out of time, and we will adjourn the hearing with thanks to both of you for your good work and for your testimony today.
Thank you.